Hello everybody. So in this session, we are going to discuss about the thyroid inhibitors. So the learning objectives for this class are classification of thyroid inhibitors, and then we shall look into the pharmacology of each of the subclasses. So first, we'll just, before we go into thyroid inhibitors, let us have a brief introduction, just like we had for the thyroid hormones. So thyroid inhibitors are the drugs which are used to lower the functional capacity of the hyperactive thyroid gland. Now, the hyperactive thyroid states, you already are aware from your first year classes, they are referred to as hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis, where there's an excessive secretion of thyroid hormones. So it is of two types, Graves' disease and toxic nodular goiter. So in Graves' disease, it's an autoimmune disorder in which the antibodies are binding to the TSH receptor on the thyroid cells, and they will start stimulating the thyroid gland just like the TSH. So more production of T4 and T3 will be produced. In this case, the TSH levels will be low as a result of feedback inhibition by the large amounts of T4 and T3 that is produced. And in the case of toxic nodular goiter, you are having a swelling which is producing a thyroid hormone which is independent of TSH. There is no stimulation by the TSH. It is just independently producing a large amount of thyroid hormones. Now, the features of hyperthyroidism are the intolerance to heat, when you are having some kind of tachycardia, high blood pressure, then there will be weight loss because of the high basal metabolic rate, muscle wasting, diarrhea. You can have menstrual changes like amenorrhea, and there can be tremors, there can be exophthalmos. So if you have gone to surgery department and have seen a thyroid case, you would be clinically examining patients for signs of hyperthyroidism, which includes this exophthalmos. You'll be looking for some tremors. You'll be asking for their symptoms like intolerance to heat, weight loss, symptoms like diarrhea, symptoms like amenorrhea, and all these things. These are all features that relate to hyperthyroidism. Now, classification of thyroid inhibitors is very important because from this topic, this is often asked. So you have to write the classification as is being discussed here. So first one is inhibit the hormone synthesis, that is called as anti-thyroid drugs. Example is propylthiouracil, metimazole, otherwise called as carbimazole. Then you have drugs which inhibit the iodide trapping. They are called as the ionic inhibitors. Examples are thiocyanates, perchlorates, nitrates. Then the drugs which inhibit the hormone release. Examples are iodine. Iodides are sodium and potassium. And the last one, the drugs which destroy the thyroid tissue. Here we have got radioactive compounds, that is radioactive iodine, iodine 131, 125, and 123. So if you look carefully, you can see that there are drugs which are inhibiting the different steps of the hormone synthesis, that is trapping, then the synthesis, the release, and finally the destruction of thyroid tissue. One more thing I want you all to observe carefully is that all these drugs together are called as a thyroid inhibitors, whereas the drugs which inhibit the hormone synthesis, they alone are referred to as the anti-thyroid drugs. So many a times in the question paper, you people make a mistake. When you are asked to write about antithyroid drugs, you are only asked to concentrate on the drugs which inhibit the hormone synthesis. And when you're asked to write about thyroid inhibitors, you have to mention all of these drugs. After having repeated it many times, you still make a mistake in this aspect. So first we will deal with the antithyroid drugs, or otherwise called as thioamides. So if you get a question on thioamides, you're supposed to be writing about the antithyroid drugs. So example is metimazole, the other name is carbimazole. And the other example is propylthiouracil. So what's the mechanism of action? They are going to inhibit the thyroid hormone synthesis by inhibiting the principal enzyme, that is thyroid peroxidase enzyme. They also inhibit the iodination of tyrosyl residues, and they inhibit the coupling of MIT and DIT to produce thyroid hormones. So they have inhibited all these steps. They have inhibited the enzyme, they have inhibited the iodination of tyrosyl residues, and they have inhibited the coupling. So we do not have synthesis of the T3 and the T4 hormones. Propyl thiouracil, in addition, also prevents the peripheral conversion of T4 to the more active T3 form. So for this three actions are common for both these drugs, but propyl thiouracil, in addition, also inhibits the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. So what you have to observe here is that these drugs do not affect the release of the T3 and T4. That means if you already have the thyroid gland where there is already preformed T3 and T4, that will be released even after you give this drug. That will be continued to release, and they will be producing the effects for some time. So when you administer these drugs, you will not find the inhibition effect very fast, because there will be already some preformed thyroid hormone inside the gland, which will continue to release for some time. Because these drugs do not inhibit the release, they only inhibit the further synthesis of hormones. They will not inhibit the release of already preformed hormones. They are absorbed very quickly, and they're widely distributed in the body. They enter milk and they can cross the placenta. So they can have their effects on the fetus as well as the suckling baby. Then metabolized in liver and excreted in the urine. So this is very important. We have to contrast between these two drugs. That is, when you compare the potency, you are having propyl thiouracil, which is less potent. Thiouracil is highly plasma protein bound. Because of the same reason, because it is highly plasma protein bound, it is less transferred across the placenta and the milk in comparison to the carbamazole. Both of them are transferred, but when you're comparing it, this one, propyl thiouracil, is less transferred across placenta and the milk because it is highly plasma protein bound. Now, the plasma T-half is 1 to 2 hours in the case of propyl thiouracil. It is more in the case of carbamazole, 6 to 10 hours. So in the case of propyl thiouracil, the single dose acts only for 4 to 8 hours, whereas carbamazole, the single dose can act for about half to 24 hours. There is no active metabolite for propyl thiouracil. There's an active metabolite for methimazole. In the case of propyl thiouracil, you have to give multiple daily doses, obviously, because it has got a lesser or a shorter T-half, and single dose is acting only for 4 to 8 hours. In contrast, with carbamazole, you require only a single dose because you know that a single dose itself can act for 12 to 24 hours. In addition, I told you, propyl thiouracil is inhibiting the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3 in addition to the inhibition of synthesis. Now, the adverse effects of antithyroid drugs, they can end up with hypothyroidism and goiter, GI intolerance, skin rashes, joint pain. They can cause hair loss and graying of hair. Sometimes they can cause liver damage and agranulocytosis. So these are all adverse reactions which can be seen in both of these drugs. If you're asked to select one of these drugs between propyl thiouracil and carbamazole in pregnancy, obviously you'll be selecting propyl thiouracil because of the reasons that I have mentioned before. That is, it's highly plasma protein bound and it is crossing less across the placenta. Now, the therapeutic uses of antithyroid drugs, they are used for treatment of thyrotoxicosis, that is both in Graves' disease and in toxic nodular goiter. So as a definitive therapy, they are used for Graves' disease, and they are preferred in young patients who are having a short history of Graves' disease. And for the case of toxic nodule, we prefer surgery or a radiotherapy for young patients, and drugs will be preferred for toxic nodules in old patients. So in Graves' disease, you prefer the drugs for young patients, and in a toxic nodule, the drugs are preferred in elderly patients. So preoperatively, If you have to convert a patient who is having a toxic nodule to a euthyroid state, you will give this antithyroid drugs can be given. Because a patient who is having toxic symptoms, toxic means who is having high levels of thyroid hormones, will never be taken up for a surgery because he can end up with a tachycardia, high blood pressure and all on the table. And this can be sometimes fatal. So it is always required that a person who is having a toxic nodule, if he's taken up for a surgery, he has to be rendered euthyroid with the help of drugs before performing a thyroidectomy surgery. Then the drugs are also used along with iodine-131 for the initial control of hyperthyroidism and preferably in elderly. So before you start the radiotherapy, iodine-131, it is always better to control the hyperthyroidism initially with the antithyroid drugs. The advantages of antithyroid drugs over surgery or iodine-131 is that there is no surgical risk, scar, or there is not much injury to any parathyroid glands or recurrent laryngeal nerve. Hypothyroidism, even if it is occurs, it can be reversible when you stop the drug. It can be used even in children and young adults. The disadvantages are that often you have to give a lifelong treatment because the relapse rate is very high. When you stop this drug, again, the patient can go back to the hypothyroidism. It is not practical if it is used in uncooperative or unintelligent patients. So patient is not very cooperative, then he will be missing the drugs and that will not bring out the expected benefits. And the adverse effects, I already mentioned the number of adverse effects like loss of hair, graying of hair, GI intolerance, rashes and all. And again, teratogenicity also has to be considered. Though we said that propylthiouracil acid can be preferred over carbamazole, but still the risk of fetal hypothyroidism and goiter remains there with both of these drugs. Now we shift to the next class of drugs, that is ionic inhibitors. It includes thiocyanates and perchlorates, and these inhibit the iodide trapping. That's the first step in the the thyroid hormone synthesis. Now, these drugs are having a high toxicity and therefore they are not used clinically. Next, we go to the iodide salts. Now, these are the fastest acting thyroid inhibitors and they act in 2 to 7 days. How they act is that they inhibit the release of T3 and T4, and that is called as a thyroid constipation. That is, the thyroid gland is not able to release the T3 and T4. It is the thyroid constipation. We mentioned that in antithyroid drugs, it is not able to prevent the release. But in the case of iodide salts, they are able to prevent the release of thyroid hormones. The excess iodide rapidly interferes with the iodination of tyrosyl residues of thyroglobulin, resulting in reduced T3, T4 synthesis. So this is a phenomenon which is called as the Wolff-Chaikoff effect. So we mentioned that iodide is required for the thyroid hormone synthesis. But when the iodide is excess, it will result in reduced T3, T4 synthesis. This paradoxical effect is called as the Wolff-Chaikoff effect. Another effect is called as a thyroid escape. Now, this effect, that is the prevention of release of the hormones, is actually transient. That is, it is only short-lasting because the thyroid gland will escape from that inhibition and the thyrotoxicosis can return with the greater vengeance. So these are the different effects associated with thyroid salts, thyroid constipation, Wolff-Chaikoff effect and thyroid escape. So where do we use this iodide salts? So they are mainly used pre-operative preparation of thyroidectomy patients in Graves' disease. So what the solution that is available is called as a Leubold's iodine. It is 5% iodine in 10% potassium iodide solution. 5 to 10 drops per day are given for 10 days. And it is given for 10 days preceding the surgery. So what is the use of giving this Leubold's iodine is that it will make the gland firm, it will become less vascular, and this will be very easy for the surgeon to operate upon. So it is also decreasing the thyroid release, and it is somewhat helping in the attaining the euthyroid status before surgery. Other than that, it is also making the gland firm, less vascular, and easy to operate upon. In the case of thyroid storm, the thyroid storm is an emergency situation where a patient who was having thyrotoxicosis is taken up for a surgery without rendering him euthyroid. So on the table, when the thyroid gland is operated upon, a large amount of thyroid hormones are released to circulation. It can lead to tachycardia, high blood pressure, arrhythmias, and it's a very, very hypothermia, and it's a very emergent situation, and it can even be fatal. So when a thyroid storm occurs on the surgical table, again, Lupul's iodine is given 6 to 10 drops as a treatment for that. Then for the prophylaxis of endemic goiter. Okay, now this you would have heard in all the cases, like places which are having less iodide in the soil. People usually give iodized salt. And this, for that also, these salts are used, iodide salts, usually as a food supplement available as a salt for adding in the food and all. This is given for prophylaxis of endemic goiter. And iodine salts are also used as antiseptic, as a tincture iodine, povidone iodine and all. So mainly, as far as the thyroid is concerned, these are the three uses of the iodide salts. Now, the adverse effects are basically acute adverse effects, which include swelling of lips, eyelids, angioedema of larynx. So this is more like a hyposensitivity reaction, or like more in the lines of an anaphylactic shock and all. So fever, joint pain, petechial hemorrhage, thrombocytopenia, lymphadenopathy. And this occurs mainly in individuals who are sensitive to iodine. And the chronic overdose is called as the iodism, and it is mainly characterized by inflammation of mucous membrane, salivation, sneezing, swelling of eyelids, GI disturbance, headache, and fetal or infantile goiter and hypothyroidism if it is given in pregnancy or lactation. So whenever you're writing the adverse effects of iodide salts, you have to mention both the acute as well as the chronic ones. So these are basically the more of a learning by heart. All these areas need more of learning by heart, and that is why I'm rushing off a little faster, and not much explanation is required in these situations, in these slides. Now we come to the radioactive iodine, and the one that we are using in thyroid disorders is iodine-131. This is also a very often asked short note, so you have to understand this very thoroughly. So what's the mechanism of action? So iodine-131 emits X-rays as well as beta particles. So it is emitting two types of particles, that is X-rays and beta particles. The former are useful in tracer studies, while the latter are utilized for the destructive effect on the thyroid cells. So it's the beta particles which are actually destroying the thyroid cells. So what happens is that when you administer iodine-131 orally, it gets concentrated in the thyroid. It starts emitting the radiation from within the follicles, and the beta particles, they penetrate up to 0.5 to 2 millimeter of tissue. So what do they do? These beta particles will cause these cells to undergo pycnosis, necrosis, followed by fibrosis. Since their penetration is only up to 2 millimeter of tissue, they do not cause any damage to the neighboring tissues. The radioactive iodine is administered usually as a sodium salt of iodine-131, dissolved in water and taken orally. And the T-half, you can see, is about 8 days. So the onset of action is somewhat slower, and it will act for about 16 days, because the T-half is around 8 days. Now the uses, it can be used for diagnostic purposes. That is, you can use it around 25 to 100 microgram curie is given. No damage to the thyroid cells at this dose. And therapeutic, it is three to six millicurie in Graves' disease and toxic nodular goiter. So diagnostic, as a part of the tracer studies, you can use that, and for therapeutic purpose in Graves' disease and toxic nodular goiter. The advantages, It is simple and it can be given conveniently, and this diagnostic purposes, it can be used for an can be used on an outpatient basis. It's quite inexpensive, and it is quite permanent. Means hypothyroidism that is induced is quite permanent. There is no surgical risk or scar or injury to the parathyroid glands or recurrent laryngeal nerve. It's usually preferred in an age more than 25 years, and if associated with some kind of cardiac disease or any other contraindication to surgery is present. It's preferred not much in the young patients because there is always a risk of papillary carcinoma in young patients if they are exposed to radiation. So it is usually preferred in an age group more than 25 years, and especially in people who are having cardiac diseases or people who cannot be taken up for surgery. It is used in metastatic carcinoma of thyroid, especially of papillary type or those cases of follicular carcinoma which concentrate the iodide. You can use it as a palliative therapy. So it is used for metastatic carcinoma of thyroid also, but this is also a very controversial use, not much. We prefer to use it mainly for Graves' disease and for the toxic nodular goiter. The disadvantage is that it is can cause hypothyroidism. 2 to 3 weeks it takes for response, because I already told you it has got a T half, which is quite long. It's contraindicated in pregnancy. It is not suitable for young patients because they are more likely to develop hypothyroidism, and also there is a very high risk of conversion into papillary carcinoma in more in the young patients. Genetic damage and cancer is also feared. The papillary carcinoma, risk of papillary carcinoma is also feared. Then we come to the next category of drugs, that is beta blockers. Now, these are drugs which are not mentioned under thyroid inhibitors. They are mainly sympathetic blockers, and they decrease the manifestation of thyrotoxicosis, which are due to the sympathetic overactivity. In the initial class, I had mentioned that thyroid hormone produces activity, direct action as well as actions because of sympathetic overactivity. Now, the beta blockers are actually decreasing the manifestations of thyrotoxicosis, which are occurring because of sympathetic overactivity, like palpitation, tremor, nervousness, and sweating. In addition, they also reduce the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. So I know the, you will remember these points, the first one, but you sometimes forget the second action. That is, it prevents the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. It is mainly used while awaiting response to the antithyroid drugs. Now, I mentioned to you that the antithyroid drugs also take a little bit time to start its action. So during that time, you can give beta blockers also in addition to the antithyroid drugs to overcome the symptoms. It's also given along with iodide for preoperative preparation before subtotal thyroidectomy. So we mentioned that Lugol's iodine is given before surgery. The same thing, even beta blockers can be given before surgery. And during the thyrotoxic crisis or thyrotoxic storm, again, beta blockers are also preferred. So Lugol's iodine is also used for thyroid storm, and even beta blockers are used for thyroid storm. And the final thing that we're going to discuss is about the management of thyroid storm or thyrotoxic crisis. And as I mentioned to you earlier, it's an emergency which is occurring because of a decompensated hyperthyroidism. Occurs mainly if you take up a patient who was hyperthyroid for a surgery without rendering him euthyroid. The treatment is non-selective beta blockers like propranolol, which will bring about symptomatic relief. That is, they'll control tachycardia, the high blood pressure, and they also will reduce the peripheral conversion of T4 to the more T3, more active T3 form. Then you can give propyl thiouracil. It reduces the hormone synthesis and also prevents the peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. You can give Lugol's iodine, which will prevent the hormone release from the thyroid gland. You can give corticosteroids to cover any adrenal insufficiency, and they also will inhibit the peripheral T4 to T3 conversion. So the corticosteroids are mainly, it's an emergency situation. So it will try to cover any adrenal insufficiency which can accompany a surgical emergency. Diltiazem can be added. Diltiazem is a calcium channel blocker which can be given if tachycardia is not controlled by propranolol alone. Along with that, you have to give rehydration, you have to give anxiolytics, you have to give external cooling because the patient might be having high temperatures, and you have to give appropriate antibiotics. So again, a management of thyroid storm is often asked along with an essay question. So you have to remember these drugs which are used for thyroid storm. So in this topic, mainly you are supposed to be learning the classification of thyroid inhibitors very thoroughly. You are supposed to learn the diagram or the figure of the thyroid hormone synthesis, and you should be able to mark the sites of action of the drugs. I haven't shown you that in the slides, but if you can, if it is very easy to mark these slides, the sites, because the classification itself is indicative of the areas which are being inhibited. You can easily mark that on the diagram. Then you have to make a short note on antithyroid drugs or thiamides. Radioactive iodine also is asked as a short note, and the management of thyroid storm also you have to learn thoroughly. So these are the important areas from this topic. And with that, we come to the end of this class. Thank you.